come forward, come forward.
My name is Jed Dixon. I'd like to welcome you all to coming to the Walt and Louise Simonson panel. Or should I say Weezie?
Whatever, Weezie, whatever.
Okay.
I answered to some of the things.
All right. Do you guys want to start with the Q&A, or do you want to?
Sure.
Do any of you guys want to know who we are? Or do you all know who we are? I don't make any assumptions about this stuff.
Well, my girlfriend is. She just got into comics when she got together with me, so she needs.
And I see you guys laugh and look. Someone needs to leave. Nobody knows these answers to start with. We all have to start somewhere. Oh, this mic is really amazing.
It is amazing.
Walt and Louise Simonson, we are both professionals in the American comic book scene, largely originally in mainstream comics, by which we mean like Marvel Comics or DC Comics. When we started, it was those companies and Warren magazines, which is black and white. Horror comic company. And then the funny ones like Archie Comics and Casper the Friendly Ghost and Harvey Comics and so on. But we were in this is in short form.
We've been here since the dawn of time.
or we are older than dirt. So I went to New York in 1972 with the idea of doing comics or trying to get into business. It was a much smaller business. Really awful movies that have come out about comic book characters, but not much. The media stuff that you have now, none of that stuff existed, and neither did things like FedEx or the internet or any of the stuff you take for granted now, cell phones, all that stuff. It was like, you know, we barely could make fire in 1972. And so, at that time, if you wanted to do comics in the mainstream, you had to move to New York City, beat Marvel and DC were both in the city, both in Manhattan. And you would do your, if you got a job, you would do your art or your writing, and you would physically go to the office and take the work in and give it to your editor. And what that meant was it was really like working almost in a small village. You knew everybody. The great thing about it then is it meant that I knew, as we did a little later, we knew, well, actually at the same time, in a different part, everybody that was in comics. You met, you know, Neil Adams, Joe Kubert, Alex Toth, all the other, some guys like John, you know, Alex didn't live in the city and came in rarely. They wouldn't mail their stuff in. You had something called special handling in the mailbox, in the post office. You set it in and it might get there in 2 or 3 days with special handling, and maybe it wouldn't. But what it meant was it was small and you knew everybody. And so I came to New York in 72. I ended up being lucky enough to have some work that appealed. By complete accident, I was shown to the office of the editor-in-chief at DC Comics, Carmine Infantino. Carmine was a complete fluke. Carmine loved my stuff for whatever reason. Other editors already turned me down. Carmine called 3 of his editors in and made them all give me a job on that day. Now back then, comics had short stories in the backs of them. They don't have that much anymore anywhere.
Marvel does it occasionally still, but it's always like a 2-3 page backup as a writer.
Back then it was like 6-page stories. I did 1 3-page story. They were short. But basically, it was the mystery magazines, the horror magazines, and even war magazines. And you learned your craft by doing these really short little stories. And, you know, nobody cared. There wasn't a kind of organized fandom. There were barely conventions for comics at that time. There had been a couple, but not many. And since there was no internet, you didn't get flamed for doing an awful job. Because people would write in, we see the letter 3 months later, who cares? Our job's 3 months old, I don't care about getting a job anymore. So you could learn your craft, not quite in privacy, but you could really learn how to draw it out, tell stories.
And they would pay you for it. So it was kind of like you're getting paid to learn at that point, and that was the best.
It wasn't like a lot of money.
No.
Didn't get paid a lot.
But it was better than you having to pay.
That's right. It was better than you going to school and having to pay the school to learn. There were no schools for comics back in those days. So I lucked out. I had 3 short stories. I did 2 of them. One of them, the editor and I, without ever saying a word, mutually agreed I would never do the story. Because he didn't, I mean, it was fine. He put out stories, I mean, he was a neat guy, and I liked his stuff, but it was not the kind of comic book stories I ever wanted to do. And I don't think I was doing any kind of art that had any resemblance to the work he liked. And the upshot was that he never mentioned it again, and I never mentioned it again. And after the first 2 stories that I did, I began getting a little work from another editor where I could do little backups, like this 3-page job. And then slowly worked my way into comics. So I began doing comics, this is 1972, and since that time, Well, Weezie got into comics, I'll let you know that part of the story, at almost the same time. We didn't know each other at the time. She was a single mom in New York, but again, because of the comics connection, you kind of meet everybody, and there were a lot of babes back in comics. I kind of lucked out. It worked out really well for me. And since at the time I was a complete social retard, it worked out really well, because otherwise I would still be a bachelor. So it was just fine. But we ended up, we really met because she was a good friend of the couple, one of them, and the guy who was my editor on a few of these little short stories. I had begun to work with closely a gentleman named Archie Goodwin, who was no longer living, but Archie was one of the best writer-editors comic books ever had. He was phenomenal. And I began doing a strip with Archie called Manhunter as a backup story. Made my career. It made my career when I got that assignment and did it with Archie for about a year. And it turned out Weezie was a good friend of theirs, lived on the west side where they lived. Weezie had a daughter who was a good friend of their daughter. And Julie stayed at their house often after school while Weezie was working as a single mom. She had her own job. And I called Archie's house from our apartment one night to talk about something in the strip we were doing, and this fabulous voice answered the phone. I thought, oh, Karen. And I told her who I was, and I was looking for Archie. She said, oh, you draw the most wonderful hands. I beg your pardon? Oh, I don't know what to say. I guess. So it probably helped that I wasn't looking at her directly. That probably worked out okay. But she ended up getting into comics professionally. Really on a fluke, the way you tell that.
It's again in little New York, the small town. It's who you know. And I had a friend. I had read the Warren books, which were black and white horror comics and war comics. Back, I guess before I got into comics, I liked them. And it turned out I had a friend who worked at the company, and I was working in advertising promotion for a magazine company at the time. And Michelle said, there's an opening in our company, and you can do it, and it pays better than your job. Why don't you apply? And I said, okay, sure. And I applied, and I got the job. It was for the production department, and it turned out I was less than brilliant in production, which was, lettering corrections and that kind of thing, paste ups and mechanicals. But it turned out, because it was a very small company, they had everything needed doing. And there weren't enough hands to do it, so that it turned out I was actually really good at doing letters columns, at writing advertising copy, and doing editorial stuff. So they just created an assistant editor position for me and kept me around.
Got her out of the production block as quickly as possible.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. Many artists are grateful for that. So I worked at Warren. I was an assistant editor, and then became the editor of The Line, and then eventually went over to Marvel and worked there as an editor, and then started writing stuff.
She was at Marvel for 4 years, and then I have to say,
I never know how long I did anything. Walter is my
calendar. I'm a keeper of the dates, but what happened was, after Weezie, I will say this in an unbiased way, one of the best editors comics ever had. You can ask Chris Claremont, he will tell you exactly the same thing, and so will a number of other freelancers who work for Weezie. But
I'll tell you what, I think the secret of being one of the best editors ever is you hire people whose work you love, and you encourage them to do what they do, and then you look like a genius. Guess what? That's because you hired all these brilliant people, so there you go. That's the secret, if anybody needs a secret.
I will say, Weezie also had the gift that Archie had, which is that freelancers who work for her, as they work for him, for how this works, and I don't think you can teach it, wanted to do their best work for her, as they wanted to do their best work for Archie, because you knew you were getting the best on the other side of the desk. And so you really wanted to do what you could do as well as you could do it. But the other job was, and also Weezie, before computers, turned out she was phenomenal at putting out, like 6, 7, 8, 9 books in a month. And she would know where every book was and what stage it was in. This book is half pencil, this book is 2/3 ink, this book's been lettered, this book is still at the inkers, this book hasn't been lettered, the colorist has some of these pages, and she can keep track of all that stuff with very few flubs on that, but like one, that's it.
That was in the olden days when I actually had a mind. I've got a half brain.
That's right.
Well, there's the
other half. We were younger then. We were all younger then. But after 4 years, well, let me see, 74, 4 years of editing a Warren, 4 years of editing a DC, she edited, I mean a Marvel, she edited for 8 years, and after that, it became too easy for her. There was no challenge in putting these books out, and the writers made good work, she was putting out the book. My favorite bit about that is that she used to, we were living together in Manhattan by then, and so, and, you know, with her daughter was young, so you had to get her off to school, so Weezie would get her in the office around 10 o'clock, or 10:30, or maybe 11, and then she would stay late after work, and I'd be home working when Julie came back, and, you know, every so often the guys that ran the old corporation from the year, used to own Marvel a million years ago, they would get cranky about people coming in late, and not, you know, keeping office hours, as if it were a real company, which comics is only a kind of a semi-real company, really, or it used to be, it's more real now, which is, but a lot less fun, and so, they would get cranky about this, and Weezie was one of the people who would be, they'd be cranky because she was coming in so late. And then one of the guys, I don't know what Mike's official title was, Mike Hobson, but they did some checking to see how books were selling. And it turned out Weezie had all the best-selling books at Marvel, and maybe some of the hardest.
Well, I put out more pages than anybody
else. And then it was like, okay, you can come in whenever you feel like. We're happy to have it, which is not entirely usual for every company. Some companies would say, I'm sorry, we don't care. Marvel said, that's just fine. Come in as you wish. And whatever you're doing,
keep doing what you're doing. And
just
honestly,
keep doing it.
It made sense. I had a batch of people in California. So I was sort of on California time.
A bunch of freelance.
This is my big rationalization, because, you know, you need a reason for this.
That's right.
So that I could, you know, interact with the California people, so, you know, easily.
So she did that. Anyway, because of my phone call to Archie's earlier, we met maybe about almost a year after that. And then because I was such a complete social retard, it took me a while to be able to talk to her face to face. But in the end, it all worked out okay. It all worked out great. So she got into comics a little after I did, literally speaking, but not because of me. It was not. We actually began dating, I think, in, she got her job at Warren in June. And we began dating in August, and it didn't have anything in 74. Had nothing to do with my being in comics or her. It was her friendship and her other things that got her in the business. You know, we got together in a sense because we both knew the same people. So you're kind of in the same social circle, and as a result, you do meet people kind of in the way that works out. But it wasn't really, I didn't get into comics, and that was just good.
I didn't get into comics either.
Yeah, it was great because since we're both freelancers, you kind of get like this deadline idea. And the fact that, of course, as a freelancer, my deadline is 3 weeks from now. Well, I'm busy playing Zelda Wind Waker this week. And then I'll get back to doing all the work next. And then the week after, I'm going berserk trying to get things done. And my wife doesn't really upbraid me too much about that. She usually has a pretty good sense of where the buckshot is. So, but we do know couples where they say one of the couples is not a freelancer. It's something that's hard for them to adjust this kind of feast or famine approach to work.
Yeah, we know examples, say when the family is supposed to go off on a vacation to Florida, and the mom has the bag packed, and the kid's in the car, and the dad is still there trying to draw, I don't know, Superman or something, finish off his pages so that he can get out of town. And then sometimes it makes people a little perturbed.
I'm not saying it's unjust.
No. So, you know, at least, you know, I kind of know what to expect. So it does make, I think it makes it easier to have a freelancer background.
So that's what we do and we've done, and we...
Don't forget to talk about volleyball.
We'll get to that eventually. So Weezie writes comics. After she left as an editor, she wanted to become a freelance writer. She came up with an idea. She wanted to be editor-in-chief at Marvel. But what Weezie did not want to do, I must speak for her, what she did not want to do was, as an editor already, she felt there was a conflict of interest to write one of the other books of Marvel that some other freelancer was already writing. Because really, if they change the editorial, the creative team of the book, it does mean that this guy's getting a job, but it means that guy's losing a job. In the old days, I think not so much now, editors often, if there things had to change, they had to move a freelancer off a book for whatever reason, they generally tried to find some other book for that guy to actually pick up and do.
Yeah,
was back in the day when we actually thought of artists and writers as human beings instead of cogs of the machine, which happens, actually, it happens sometimes now.
It does happen sometimes now, but I think it's rarer for that kind of consideration to be going on. So she didn't want to take an existing book at Marvel and start writing it, but she wanted to write. She was really done with everything. And so she came up with an idea for a comic, a book called, turned out to be called Power Pack, which is really a story of two parents who have four young children,
5 to 12,
who got superpowers and became superheroes, and their parents didn't know. It's a fantastic comic. Weezie wrote about 50 issues of it and spun off to other writers. But her issues were fabulous. She had two artists who did most of the work who were fabulous at drawing children, which not everybody who draws comics can draw. And she liked the idea. A young woman came into the office looking for work that day, had never done comics in her life, June Brigman, but she could draw children. So you should know the rest of the stuff. This is what June.
All right, okay. So June comes into my office. I was editor of X-Men and a batch of other stuff. And she's looking for work. And I had all the chairs were full of that particular, little game. I didn't need any artists. But I had this idea for Power Pack, and I asked her if she could draw children. And she said, oh, sure. I used to sketch kids at Six Flags. One of these people who, sat there around and did caricatures there back in Georgia. I said, okay, great. Well, here's the script. It's got descriptions of the kids. Draw the kids. And if I like what you draw, then I'll submit us as a team to Shooter, who was after me to write stuff.
So, Jim Shooter was the other Shooter in Marvel at that time.
Establishing child. Jim came in with these fabulous little drawings. I had the little guy named Jack, who's one of the younger boy, and he was like his arms folded and a little pouty face, and Alex had braces. I mean, it was just, the kids were wonderful. What Jim did, she took what I had given her and pushed it, so that you got all the emotion that I had hoped to have in the characters, actually, on those just little sketches. So I said, all right, this is great. We're in, we're gonna submit it. So I had told the idea to Shooter initially, and Shooter said, well, it's kind of a weird idea. Maybe we'll get a miniseries, maybe a graphic novel thing out of it. So I said, okay, great, and I turned it in. Shooter loved it. He said, I have seen, what? Because he said it's to hyperbole, right? I have seen presentations for screenplays that are not this good. You now have a series, and your first issue is double-sized, and it's due in 2 months. And it's like, June and I are going,
probably some of the word was used there. There's a meeting children about, so.
June has never drawn a comic before, and this is the first one I've actually written. So, so we did it, and it turned out really well, and people seemed to like it. So, I mean, June was perfect. Honestly, I couldn't have gotten a better artist for it.
No, there was nobody else in the business could have done better kids than she was doing.
And then I went on, and I totally had the writing bug at that point, and then started writing other stuff and quit editing, and ta-da.
So she quit her editing job and became a writer.
I did.
The comic, it ran for a while. Once Weezie was off, didn't feel the same after that. She really had the understanding of the children. But what happened was that book of all the books, either one of us had done, probably has like maybe the best fans. They were loyal, they were sweet, they were just what you want out of that.
Yeah, all my Power Pack fans, they were the best. They were kind, nice, good people. So yeah, I love that.
Not that the rest of you guys aren't, but there are degrees of all this.
Every book has different kinds of fans. Like Frank Miller's fans are a little sometimes. But my fans, the Power Pack fans were just the best. I hadn't realized at the time, I had done it thinking that I was writing it for myself when I was 12. I was writing it for my 12-year-old self. I was afraid that it was not reaching children because, most of the, we had no way of knowing who was buying the books. At the time, there was no demographic study or anything done. But, and we would get letters and we would kind of try to judge from the letters who was buying it. Occasionally I'd get a letter from a kid, but mostly it was letters from grown-ups, so I thought, this is totally missing the mark I had intended. But now at these conventions, so many people come up and say, oh, I bought it when I was 12, and I say, yes! Those are my people. So anyway, that was the end.
So we've done a lot of comics from other characters over the years.
Yeah.
Weezie writes, and occasionally edits still. She's more out of comics and doing more in the way of like kids' books, mostly licensed, say, through PC, kid chapter books for kids, or even non-chapter books for kids for up there kept DC's character, like Superman or Batman or whomever. I mostly still write and draw comics. Some comics I write, some comics with other artists, some comics I draw with other writers, some comics I write and draw myself. And between us, we've done most of the mainstream characters, I'd say up to about 20 years ago. Guys like Deadpool, that's all a generation beyond us, so we haven't done most of those characters.
So for somebody who asked, so who are you guys anyway?
I'll never ask that question again. It's true. Well, we're just, that's it, we're done. So do you guys have any questions? Or have we answered everything? Yes, sir.
In terms of the mutant massacre in particular, keeping a narrative not dependent on each other but still connected, just what are your thoughts on that in general? Because most crossovers seem to be dependent.
We're really good. We're really good. And also, I'm wondering about that, there weren't any models for it. That's the first really big crossover, I think. There were, Bill Mantlo wrote an Olympic story, or a story that was supposed to come out in 1980 for the Olympics, that involved a lot of Marvel characters in a big book. I mean, I think it was a tabloid size, something like that. I forgot the name of it. It was a little weird because that was the year the president, I think at the time, the Jimmy Carter, decided we were not going to go send anybody to the Olympics because of stuff that was going on politically with Russia, was that right? I forgot how it all worked out. But what's that? Oh, lovely. Well, boy, shame on them. But Bill, that may have been the first one that really had a lot of characters to sort of, you know, it's like a fan dream, you know, always guys in the same book. But the Mutant Massacre had kind of a different origin, which I would defer to my wife on.
Okay, the origin of that is Chris Claremont, who wrote the X-Men, it had an artist, Paul Smith, who drew it's a long story. There was an underground environment where a lot of mutants lived. These mutants were called Morlocks, and there were supposed to be like 30 or 40 of them. Paul drew a vast cavern with probably 300 Morlocks in it. Chris said, oh, this is too many Morlocks. I've got to kill some of them.
I'm thinking maybe it was thousands. It was like some vast underground
landscape. So I said, Chris, I've invented these guys and they're going to come in and just take these Morlocks out. And I said, oh, that's too big a story. Because the Morlocks were, you know, running through the Marvel Universe, at least the mutant part. It was too big a story for just Chris to do by himself. I said, can I play? And Chris said, okay, sure. So
Chris was a good friend. This is part of that small village thing of comics.
We were doing X-Factor at the time, and I didn't have Power Pack. And Chris was writing The Mutants and X-Men. So
I was writing Thor.
You're writing Thor. So we just got together and talked about it. I mean, Chris got to do the spine of it in that we knew what he wanted to do, which was take out a batch of Morlocks. And we were able to take our characters and sort of work them into the events that, you know, Chris wanted to, you know, help fulfill Chris's dream of destroying Morlocks. So that's really how it happened. I mean, we were able to make it probably come out as it did, because it was, first of all, creation from the bottom up, as in, it was all of us wanting to get together and play in the same sandbox. And so it was not dictated from above at all.
And that's why there aren't others.
It was just the three of us, really.
It was almost like parallel play, in a way. You know how little kids, 2-year-olds play side by side, but not exactly with each other?
Or every adult in this room has got an iPhone and sits there side by side with a girlfriend going, what are you doing at the same time in parallel play?
So we were able to coordinate it that way. And what Chris did in his book was not dependent on what we did in our book. But each of us were in the same environment.
and worked out ways to kind of have the stories fit. So I ended up drawing a big diagram that came out as a poster at comic book shops, a freebie that showed, it was like using, it had a picture of all the, I think all the covers, and then it was all connected by pipes, kind of like chutes and ladders or something like that. And it showed how it fit, how the different issues of Thor, X-Factor, X-Men, New Mutants, and Power Pack, how, and kind of how to read them in a way to make the whole story unified. And we wanted to call it the Mary Marvel Marching Mutant Massacre Map. But Marvel thought that was in bad taste. I don't know where that was coming from. So maybe we call it the Mutant Massacre Map or something, and we had to back off on that a little. But that came out as a freebie. It was a two-color black and red poster that came out. There were a bunch of figures running on the bottom of the characters that were in the crossover of a lot of them. And, you know, we just got to play, and it was organic, and then we worked it out amongst ourselves at a time when nobody had crossovers or knew what really did any of that stuff. I mean, there had been books where, you know, Submariner crossed over in Iron Man went back to Submariner or something like that, but nothing on this scale, nothing quite like this had been done before.
Also, it took place in the fall, and the common knowledge was that you couldn't sell comics to anybody in the fall because the kids were all going back to school, and that's where their money and their interest was. And I thought that was just stupid. So I said, okay, well, let's see if we can sell some comics in the fall. And Mutant Massacre seemed like a kind of a good, I don't know, gimmick, but it was a good story. It was a story that we wanted to do, but it also turned out to be kind of fell in the right time frame for us. So I said, all right, well, let's see what we can do in the fall. And it unfortunately sold gangbusters. It sold a lot of comics. So then the next fall, Jim Shooter said, oh, well, you're doing a crossover this fall also, and this is what you're going to do. And we said, oh, no, we can't. We already have something planned. Because we didn't want him to tell us what stories we were supposed to tell. We had nothing planned. We lied. But
this is all being videotaped.
Oh, that's
right. Some
So that became the Fall of the Mutants. And then, you know, we were actually building toward what the big crossover that turned out to be Inferno. That was our big plan. Oh,
but that was why, but September was traditionally a month when comic book sales went in the tank for a month or so. And it, as a reason the comic wisdom was that's when kids were spending money on school books and useful things like that, so crap like comics. And so she always, even back in her Warren days, had been interested in seeing if she could break that cycle and make comics somehow that she could get in September, get over that kind of, I mean, I don't know if it was really school books or not, but that is what happened. And so that it sold well enough that we had a dedicated crossover to file. And that's kind of where crossovers came from, really. Okay. And then they became more and more from the top down, editorial dictation about what the story is.
Yeah, it's better if things grow from the bottom up. It really is. It's much more fun for the people who are doing it anyway. I don't know about the readers, but it was a lot of fun for us to do.
But that's where that was where the Mutant Massacre came from. And that's why those books were involved, because really it was Chris and Weezie and me. I was kind of a third wheel on that vehicle, but it worked out okay.
So did we answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
And I totally understand Power Pack, because Morlocks were already in some.
They were. Yeah, I had already used a lot of Morlocks. I had my own little group of Morlocks that I played with in Power Pack.
It was fun. Are we done? I think we're through.
I have one. This is the first time I've ever asked a DC-based question in one of these, because normally I'm more of a Marvel zombie. But in the 90s, when Superman was about to die, when they covered the death and return of Superman, I started reading Man of Steel and Adventures of Superman, and I kept reading Steel when you wrote it, and I was wondering if you could talk about John Henry Irons and making sort of a working, he wasn't a millionaire or a,
no.
He was a working class, blue collar hero.
You know, he was blue collar, he was educated in that he was an engineer.
Yeah.
His origin was that after Superman died, there were four different Superman books, and each of us, again, I think it was more organic, we chose to create a substitute Superman. Someone who would try to step in and fill Superman's shoes. My character that I chose to do was I invented John Henry Irons, who was this big black guy, an engineer, who had an one point been saved by Superman, and when Superman dies, he tries to be the person that Superman was, maybe, you know, so he builds himself a super suit, and like Iron Man kind of, actually. I didn't think about that at the time, because I was really stupid, but really it was kind of like Iron Man.
We're in a big hammer.
In a big hammer. John Henry is, of course, named after the character John Henry, who's a folk hero. We were trying to do the soul of Superman. So what kind of question? Just ask me a question, I'll answer it.
I loved the family dynamic when he moved to DC and gave him his supporting cast, and his family felt so much more real than the supporting cast felt more real than anything else except for Spider-Man that I was reading at the time.
Nice.
They were very fleshed out, and I was wondering if you could talk about the family dynamic a little bit and how that.
The John Henry's family. John Henry's from Washington. He lived with his grandmother and his grandfather. Grandfather alive? I can't remember if he was alive then or not.
No,
he was dead then, right? Okay, who can remember? It's been so long. He had a sister-in-law whose husband had died, and several nieces and nephews, and there were a couple of other kids who were foster kids who lived in the house also. He came from a loving family. I mean, it was really almost like Superman's family, I guess it had been. You know, these were really decent, good people who were trying to do the best they could under kind of difficult circumstances, which Washington was at the time, and probably can be, you know, with a lot of gang activity and stuff like that. Heck, there was a lot of gang activity in New York City where we lived at the time. I don't even know what to say about it other than that. It was a loving interaction.
It was a very positive book.
Yeah.
He was trying to do something good for his community.
Right, yeah, he was. Because that's the soul of Superman.
Yeah.
One of the boys, the young Jamal, was getting involved with gangs, and his sister was trying to keep him from getting involved with gangs. And John Henry, of course, when he found out about it, you know, they managed to get Jamal pretty much out of the gangs. And I don't know, it was fun.
It was one of my favorite books.
I'm glad you liked it. That makes sense.
Who else has something?
Walt, you had a really great run with Fantastic Four. I really liked that. And it was my favorite Fantastic Four, actually. And I'm a big John Byrne fan.
And John's not here.
Maybe next year.
Edit that out.
Why did you end it? You were really good when that ran.
Over time, companies have kind of a gestalt. They have kind of a feeling about them. When I got into comics in the early 70s, and it lasted a long time, DC was always, even though at the time it's not what it is now, it was owned, I think, by maybe Kenny or maybe Warner by the time I was in comics, but always had a more corporate feel, whatever I mean by that, than say Marvel. Marvel always felt more small town and more, you know, DC had grown to become a company that was. Partly by accretion, they bought other characters and bought different things and became larger. Marvel was more a big bang kind of place where, you know, two or three or four guys were responsible for this explosion of all these guys out that other people began building on. And maybe it gave DC, I mean, Marvel more of a unified feeling. I mean, even when things were quite different, I mean, Frank could write Daredevil, which was a completely different book from the kinds of Thors that I was writing. I could do Thor, and yet, you know, you had no difficulty believing that Daredevil and Thor lived in the same town, more or less, even though they're really different the way they were being written. But at that time, it was still possible to have that feeling. But the gestalt of the company, I mean, a lot of it depends on who's running it, who's in charge, and who the, you know, editors are, all that kind of stuff. And sometimes that does change over time. I used to think it was pretty much the same all the time. And it still is. You can still go back and trace things going on now that go back to the way a company's done things for years. But the short version really is that the feeling at Marvel for me was changing by the end of the 80s. It was becoming, Shooter was gone, I mean, which was not a surprise, but Jim was gone, Tom DeFalco had been the editor for a while, editor-in-chief for a while. But the staff was changing, and it was beginning to take Marvel directions. I wasn't that interested in it. I mean, I've been a Marvel guy, but I read Marvel comics in the 60s. I loved doing the characters, had a great time. But it became a different place to work. And what that means is, I felt that some of my creative energy was being spent kind of maybe moving in a different direction than where the company itself was going. And after a while, you don't want to spend your creative energy in those kind of endeavors. You'd like to put it into the book. And so I just thought, you know, at that time, I'd been under contract with Marvel for most of that time. I'd been to Marvel like 17 years. And it began to feel to me like, you know, it's probably time to move on. I mean, there's no, you don't have to be in the same place all the time forever. Most people change jobs. How many times in America in the course of their career? Four, five, six, whatever it is, it's a bunch of times. But I've had the same job really since I was 25. But I've moved companies occasionally. And usually it's because I kind of feel my time is about done. Whatever that is, it's like being worthy to hold the hammer. I'm not quite sure what worthy means in that case, but you know it when you see it. And so I, or you feel it. And I kind of felt time had come to kind of move out of that. And it was, that was one of the things that was going on at that time, and this is just generally probably DC as well, is that, although I didn't run into a DC for a while, but that was the beginning of the era of top-down creativity rather than bottom-up. Okay, we're going to be doing crossovers, you may have a long, and I like doing long stories. I like stories like doing the Surtur War, which is like 11 or 12 or 13 or 14 issues of Marvel or whatever, Thor. And in the FF, it was this time story that kind of went on in little chapters, but it was this whole long thing, really. And then when somebody says, oh, and by the way, 2 months from now you're doing a crossover with, like, you know, the Joker or Apocalypse or whoever it is, that gets in your way if you're trying to run long stories. I ran into that with the Avengers. I wrote the Avengers for 11 months, and initially I had a lot of fun doing it, but then that was the beginning of the era of tied continuity. Now, I don't care much about tied continuity. I've said elsewhere, and I'm paraphrasing, P.D. James, who was a mystery writer and a novelist, she uses a different kind. Didn't say it's quite the same way, but I think continuity is a good servant but a poor master. And if you're doing stories because of the continuity, you're doing stories for the wrong reason. This is just me. And in the Avengers, for example, I found that I was being told I'd be in the middle of a three-part story. They would say, this is not a real example, but that you told me, well, you know, Thor's going to be in, I'd be told to be an editor, my editor or somebody higher up. Thor's going to be in outer space in March, so you can't use him in the Avengers that month. Well, I'll be in the middle of a three-part story come March, and suddenly I've got to write him out of the story and write him back in somehow. And it kind of, after, and that's just not how I work very well. There may be people who can do that stuff flawlessly and fluidly. It just isn't me. And so I could kind of see the way things are going editorially. You know, this just isn't my approach to what I want to do. And so it's not why I got into comics. I've said that elsewhere and other reasons. And that was kind of how the FF was. I didn't have to write them in other ways exactly, but there were things that I'd done. I mean, I did it after the Avengers, but I ran into the Avengers where, when I was on the Avengers, I can give better examples there. Reed and Sue were not in the Fantastic Four for the last, most of my run. Steve Englehart was the writer. He'd written them out of the book and put a couple other people, I forget who, in the Fantastic Four. And which I, you know, that's, I got nothing about that, it's fine. I don't care. But I think Reed and Sue are fabulous characters. I think they're great characters. And I thought, well, wouldn't it be really cool to put those guys in the Avengers? And could you imagine Reed Richards, accustomed to the habit of command, right next to Captain America, accustomed to the habit of command? How's that going to work out in the middle of some crisis? And I thought this would be a really interesting dynamic for a while, especially, and also it's something you've never seen before. And how many times do you write something you've never seen before in a comic? Especially comics like 30 years old. And so I got permission, all the way down the line, all the way to my editor-in-chief, thank you, Tom, and built up my storyline. So in issue 300, that's why I was going to have a new team, guys that weren't going to have other continuity problems I had to worry about. And the issue before I got there, I was told, oh, by the way, we're putting Reed and Sue back in the FF, and you can't use them. You can use them for an issue. I said, oh, great, so I'll be lying to my audience now for the last 6 months as I built up to this thing. He said, how about we use them at least for two or three issues? It doesn't look complete fake. And they said, oh, well, okay. But by that time, it felt like a fake to me. I thought, all the stuff I've been building up to and the ideas I had for storylines, I'm going to have to jettison and rethink. And so in the Avengers, I thought, this just is not the book I need to be writing right now. I can't write this way. And so in the FF, I didn't run into that problem in quite the same way, but you could see editorial was changing in a way that I just didn't find as conducive to the kind of work I like to do. And so I said, you know, I was on it for a year and a half. I mean, nowadays, a year and a half is forever. I keep seeing stuff on the web. Yeah, Simonson, what a short run of the FF. It's 18 issues, you schmuck. It's like, nowadays, that's like forever. What's the problem? But, it's all context. And so I decided the time to come to Vail. So I tried to wrap it up so the whole story kind of made a complete loop, my time loop that I was doing, and which I did, and I really enjoyed it. I loved doing those characters. I'd like to have done a longer run on them. They were a lot of fun to do. But that was kind of what happened. I just thought I better find something else to do. So I did. And I'd been at Marvel a long time by then, and probably I think the whole time to go just find some fresh places to tell stories.
Everything you do is very good, so it doesn't matter.
Well, thank you.
All right, who else had a question? You in the back, sir.
It's a double question for both of you. Who's your
favorite? We have a lot of dumb answers, so we're going to be fine.
Here's some dumb answers. Who's your favorite Silver Age artist and current artist? Who's your favorite Silver Age writer and current writer?
Yeah, to tell you the truth, I'm not sure what the Silver Age is.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand it. I see myself now as a Bronze Age artist in some of the stuff on the web. I'm going, really? I don't feel like freaking.
And we're totally not connected with the really new stuff, so the present writers, we're going to do a major disservice to
or present artists.
Yeah.
I mean, there are a bunch of artists I love. I don't look at them. I don't divide them essentially in historical periods. Like that, I'm an enormous Jack Kirby fan. Mark out here is probably a bigger Jack Kirby fan than I am. He certainly knows more about Jack than I do. But I think Jack was a watershed artist in American comics. I think, especially in the mainstream superhero stuff, he's a little like Orson Welles would be now. If you read, or if you see Citizen Kane, have you guys ever seen it? But it's a pretty cool movie, no matter how you look at it. But Orson Welles did a bunch of stuff in that movie that nobody had ever done in film before. He was like 20? He was incredibly young. For example, you go into a room, there's ceilings. Nobody did photographs, did movies with rooms that had ceilings. They never showed that much of the room before. They just showed the set. So he suddenly opened it up and made it into an entire environment. There's a lot of other stuff he did as well, the way he did focus, the way he did a lot of things. And now, all that stuff done all the time has been for years. No one looks at Citizen Kane and goes, oh my God, there's ceilings there. You just go, well, it's an okay movie. I like that film, it was okay. You have no idea how revolutionary the movie was when it came out. And Jack's a little like that. A lot of stuff that Jack did or created, I mean, I think their artists are pre-Jack Kirby or post-Jack Kirby. We're well post Jack Kirby now. But I really think that he created a visual vocabulary. I kind of think it was so powerful that it kind of cleaned out most of American mainstream comics, except for superheroes, about the time when Marvel was rising in the ascendancy. And I haven't really worked this out scholastically, I could be wrong. But a lot of books, like the world books, the mystery books, and the other genres of comics, began fading away somewhere in there. And I think the problem is Jack did such a powerful vocabulary for American mainstream superheroes. He just kind of swamped everything else. He was hard to look at other books and had the same kind of excitement that you got looking at one of Jack's books. I mean, most of you think of Jack in terms of power now, energy and power and guys hitting each other and whatever. But besides being a fountain of ideas, a lot of subtle stuff going on you don't think about now. He did a series called The Fourth World for DC Comics with the New Gods and Mr. Miracle and Jimmy Olsen and the Forever People. And in that series, for example, there's a very minor character, throwaway character named Kanto the Assassin, who was the personal assassin of Darkseid himself. And Kanto's not in very many panels, in a few bits here and there's a Mr. Miracle, he and Mr. Miracle interact briefly. And he affects the kind of Renaissance quality about himself, about his costume, about his dialogue, and about his acting, bowing, and doing a bunch of sort of grandiose gestures in like a Renaissance style. And that's all there with body language. Now, most of you with Jack, with a lot of energy and punching people and breaking apart walls and Kirby matter being created and Kirby energy, crackle blowing things apart. And yet there's all this characterization of people's postures and their body language, all the stuff that Jack did. So everybody that came after Jack was picking up on what he was doing, or a couple generations later moving away from it, but it's all kind of based back to that. So for me, more than anybody else in, certainly in American mainstream comics, he's a watershed guy. There's pre-Kirby and post-Kirby, and there aren't, I can't have anybody else I would say that about. There are other artists that have been very popular, been very hot. I don't see them in quite that same way. And there are other artists, I think John Buscema and Jose Garcia Lopez are two of the best draftsmen comics ever had, for their beauty of being able to draw the human figure and to do comics well.
And there are a batch of young guys now who draw so beautifully.
Oh man, I'm glad I'm not trying to get into comics now.
But yeah, I agree about Kirby. Kirby is, you know, the major genius. He's the Picasso of comic books.
He really is. So, no, I'll put him there, and then I'll just leave it at that, whatever age you want to put. I mean, Jack went through a lot of ages of comics, so he can qualify for most of the ages up to the present.
I don't think we've had the current comic renaissance. It wasn't based on Kirby's work back then.
No, he was certainly a core guy for a lot of that stuff, totally. So, anybody else?
Yeah.
Okay, go for it.
I was just thinking, because of this next X-Men movie, did you ever think Apocalypse would be? Because back in the day, I didn't think it was.
No, I always loved Apocalypse. I loved what...
No offense to you.
Oh, I'm not offended. I totally dig it. I've made a lot of villains. And every, you know, you never make a bad villain on purpose. Every villain, you want to be just the best. And I think Apocalypse turned out pretty well. He seemed to have caught other people's imagination, which is one of the things that you have to do with a villain. I mean, you make up somebody, and then, you know, if it catches people's imagination, after you leave, they use the villain and make up other stories about him, and then that's one of the ways the villain grows larger and more deadly, I guess. That did happen with Apocalypse. I mean, I love Apocalypse's design. Jackson Geist designed him, Walter put him on steroids. So he looks great, which is part of the battle, is that the villain has to look good, a character has to look good for people who want to draw him. But also, I just like his motivation. I love the idea of a survival of a villain who really, he only wants to make humanity better. So he runs a survival of the fittest scenario from, my own version of the Weezie verse continuity, from the end of all times. Creating strife and war and horrible events for human beings, so that the strong, the people who grow stronger live, and the people who are weak die off. He's trying to turn everybody else into a mutant, and he's trying to make the world a very nasty place, so that people become mutants faster, because he thinks that, you know, it's either become a survivor, a mutant, or, you know, end up with no people left. So really, he's only trying to help the world, but, you know, by creating wars and things. And that's what I loved about him. I love that kind of, you know, he has the best intentions. It's just that it really doesn't work out really well for a lot of people who are corpses lying on the ground. So that was what I really liked about Apocalypse. I mean, that was what I hoped for him, and I thought the design really worked so well. I loved Ship. I loved that he had this giant, vast ship, and that, you know, it rose into the city over Manhattan, and there were some buildings they had built that I didn't like, and the ship knocked them over. I love that. So I don't know. I thought that it was a good foil for X Factor, and, you know, I think it worked out. Other people did use him, and, you know, did other major stories with him. So I got lucky on that one. I mean, I've done a few characters that I thought were going to be pretty cool, and other people never used them again, so I guess it's like thumbs down for those dudes.
Well, I thought Power Tech when I was going to
that one. Oh, good. Oh, thanks.
Who else had a question over here? Just a woman over here.
Yeah. The dude, well, let me start by saying, my prime comic book 5 years was probably right just before Secret Wars. I bought some previously. And it really, right after Fall of the Mutants, so the two of you have been a big part of my comic book.
Oh, cool.
Reading life. But, well, this is more about Thor. I mean, when I read Thor, that was you. You were Thor. How do you feel the MCU has handled Thor based on your work?
You mean the movies or in the comics?
Movies.
Oh, in the movies. I think pretty well. I'm not going to say much about the movie, especially not on video. The thing I think that they did best, really, was casting Chris Hemsworth and Tom Hiddleston. I mean, you know, I love Anthony Hopkins, don't get me wrong, but Odin's got a smaller part to play in that story. And I think Chris and Tom are spectacular as Thor and Loki. I think their chemistry, I think that's the best chemistry in the movie. Sorry, anybody else that might be in that film. But they're phenomenal together. What those two movies are really about is the interaction of those two guys. And they were really into it. We didn't talk to Chris as much. We were actually on the set for the first film and met both of them. Didn't talk to Chris very much. Talked to Tom some. Tom showed Weezie how he thought Loki should be fighting. And this whole choreographed style worked out where he was got knives would appear in his hands and he'd throw them. And it was a whole graceful dance.
I love Tom.
but he was really into it, and it made a lot of difference in the character. You can see that in the movies. I think the same is true for Chris. They really, I mean, I can't imagine other guys like Christopher Reeve being cast as Superman in 1978 or the Superman movie. Boy, he was just a perfect guy. Nobody ever heard of him really before that much, I don't think. He was a perfect guy for that role, and I think that's really true of Chris and Tom. And so those movies for me are those my favorite parts of both those films. Or when those two guys were on the set together. They're just great. So I enjoyed the movies. They were fun. It's weird to see guys you created running around, not Thor, but like Curtis and Malcolm, running around the movie set. That's just really strange to see them reified into something for real.
It was cool.
It was neat. So I enjoyed them. I just think they're I thought Tom was great in the first Avengers film. And he's, you know, and it's nice because he's really, you know, he's appealing, but really he's done some really bad stuff. And that's what's nice. It's nice to be really bad, and you still find something kind of charming about him, but boy, he was really nasty. And that was pretty cool. I like that kind of thing a lot. And that's not always easy to do. It's not always, maybe it's easier for an actor, I don't think so. I'm sure it's just as hard to get a part written that's going to enable you to be incredibly nasty, and yet somehow you bring the charm.